There's often, I think, a bit of a misconception surrounding pixel art, that unless it's being used to deliberately evoke a retro aesthetic, it must just be a result of development limitations or budget restraints, a product of necessity, never choice. And with so many indie art games gaining enormous praise for their stunning visuals and art styles, pixel art games often seem to get overlooked when it comes to any critical discussion regarding art direction. It's almost as if a lot of these games are considered good in spite of their graphics and never because of them.
It feels good, it sounds good, it looks good enough.
Well, recently I stumbled across a survey from artist and budding game designer Gonzalo Alvarez as part of his undergraduate research, where he presented the participants with six different art styles for Papers, Please, one of which being the original, and asked various questions about which ones we preferred and which ones we found the most sympathetic. I found myself preferring, on every occasion, the art style used in the actual game, and I started to think about why. At first I thought it was maybe just because that's the one I was used to and the others just didn't look right. Well, then I got to thinking about why how sympathetic they look would have any significance, what would be gained or lost from them being too sympathetic or not sympathetic enough. The more I thought about it, the more I came to realise how there is just as much thought and meaning behind the visuals in Papers, Please as any other game celebrated for its visual design. The graphical style perfectly accentuates the themes of the game, perhaps more so than any other style could have, and of course Lucas Pope, the game's creator, would have had to carefully consider various different art styles, but chose the one that best presented his ideas. So let's consider what it is about the art style used that makes it the right choice. Well, firstly, it's important to understand that everything about the game, from the mechanics to the presentation, is carefully designed to convey to the player what it must be like working under that fictional communist regime. Like how the repetitive nature of the gameplay and the lack of music emphasises the feeling of monotony, or how in the late game you never quite have enough space in your cramped little booth to manage the copious amounts of documents, heightening your sense of stress as you struggle to process enough immigrants to pay your bills at the end of the day. But the art direction also plays a significant role in communicating that feeling towards the player, and it's in the pixel art, in that perceived lack of detail, that there actually lies an incredible amount of depth. The bland colour palette full of greys and browns, the polar opposite of a vibrant, colourful Western society full of garish advertisements and competing products, paints a bleak picture of a communist world with no entertainment or distractions, only your job. And the never-ending queue of immigrants, packed together like sardines on the left of the screen, are all black silhouettes, while the guards, few in number and spread out, are all blue. This creates a clear visual and spatial divide between the two groups. There are those with power and those without, and there's a stoska where you're either permitted or you aren't. So that sense of division is communicated really effectively through the visual design, and it's quite a striking image when that space is breached by someone from the other group. The simple design of the sprites, all looking exactly the same, paint a picture of uniformity. The lack of detail and colour dehumanises them. They're faceless, voiceless people in a society that doesn't value the individual, but rather the whole. But it's as they enter your immigration booth, these silhouettes literally come to life with colours and unique appearances reflecting their personal identities. You're forced to see them, if only for a brief moment, as individuals with stories to tell, emotions, attitudes, yet your job and the gameplay encourages you to treat them almost with apathy. And that's really the crux of the game, the conflict between doing what's right by yourself and your family and doing right by others, and the emotional toll that those choices take. And I think those themes are communicated to the player visually as much as they are narratively or mechanically, particularly when it comes to the design of the characters. The art style used strikes the perfect balance between simplicity and detail, and we'll come on to why that's important in a minute, but I think it's safe to say this is a balance I don't think the other art styles presented in the survey managed to achieve. And a huge thanks, by the way, to Gonzalo Alvarez for giving me permission to use these images. I really appreciate it, and you should check out his art on Twitter and Instagram. I'll put links in the description. So basically he created five other art styles to accompany the one used in the game. There's a more simplistic version of the one found in the game and a more realistic version, plus one of each in a hand-drawn art style instead of the pixel style. And if we start with the hand-drawn art styles, the main problem for me is that these feel too soft. The brush strokes, the clean-cut lines, the nice rounded edges, they don't as effectively reflect the harsh, gritty lifestyle that these characters are supposed to come from in the same way that the pixel art does. The pixel art adds a bit of roughness to everything, makes everyone look a bit hardened and wary. The hand-drawn characters look like they've stepped into your booth out of a cartoon or a painting, whereas the pixelated characters look like they've actually stepped out of a stoska. So for me, pixel art is definitely a more appropriate fit for the tone of the game than the hand-drawn art. But let's take a look at the different levels of detail in the other pixel art styles, and we can see why they're perhaps not as effective as the one used in the game. With the minimalist style, you can see it's a face, but it has little in the way of discernible features. Eyes, mouth and nose are very basic, and at this level it gives the artist very little room to experiment. The eyes give her a slightly sympathetic edge, but there's not much else. It doesn't really convey her age, and if it wasn't for the colour of her clothes and perhaps her hair, it might not even be clear that she's female. Since part of the gameplay requires you to assess these kinds of basic details about the character and then compare them with what's on their passport, such a limited art style would severely impact the gameplay. Plus, it's just a little bit too obviously a sprite, and if the game were full of these kinds of simplistic, unexpressive characters, I think they'd be too far removed from what we can identify with and relate to as humans, and so the choices you make discerning their future would carry a lot less emotional weight. On the other end of the spectrum, however, the realistic style gives away far too much. At this level, a large part of how you interpret the character is being decided by the artist. You're being overtly told all sorts of things, that she's young, attractive, looks well kept, has quite a neat hairdo, and this level of detail could tell you more about her clothing and her style, giving you a greater sense of things like fashion and affluence. These are all details which will inform how you perceive and judge her character. Her face is a lot more expressive, there's a slight glisten on her lips, you can see the whites of her eyes, which are also much bigger, and coupled with the slight bags underneath them, make her look vulnerable and sympathetic. And what's wrong with having her look this detailed? Well, again, it would work against the gameplay. There is so much obviously discernible information like age and sex, you would instantly spot any discrepancies with her paperwork. Another benefit of the art style used in the game is that it isn't always clear whether the photo in the passport matches the person or if they're the right age or sex. The game will occasionally encourage you to actively think about these things, reminding you not to overlook the simple stuff, slowing down your workflow, punishing you for rushing or being complacent. But the more detail the artist has to include, the quicker and easier it becomes to identify and perform these tasks, stripping the player of agency. What's worse, however, is it makes the experience too manipulative. One of the game's greatest strengths is the morally ambiguous decisions it presents you with, where there is no easy right or wrong answer. It works because you never really know whether or not you did the right thing. At this level of detail, however, when the game presents you with moral choices, it's far more likely you'll make and justify your decisions based on appearance. For example, if this woman presented you with an out-of-date passport but begged you to let her through anyway because, say, her father is an alcoholic and beats her and she's scared for her life, your first reaction would be to look at her face and ask, "Do I believe her?" based purely on the way she looks. And with that could come a load of personal bias. She might look like someone you know and really care about, so you instantly feel sorry for her. Or she might look like someone that you hate and you think, "Fuck helping her." Whichever you choose, you'll have probably justified your decision to yourself and be happy with your choice. The pixel art style used in the game strips away a lot of that bullshit and places the emphasis on the morality of the decision. There isn't enough detail in the face for you to make any kind of decision based on emotions or personal bias. You've no way of knowing if she's lying or not, and you never will know. Whatever you stamp on her passport, you'll just be left wondering, did I do the right thing, or did I get taken advantage of? And it's precisely that ambiguity that gives your choices meaning. You might not think the level of detail in pixel art would make that much difference to how a game plays fundamentally, and in many cases you might be right, but Papers, Please absolutely works as well as it does because of the visuals. They lend themselves both to the gameplay and the story, helping to strike a perfect balance between not giving away too much and not giving away anything at all. I just want to thank Gonzalo Alvarez again for letting me use the artwork he created for this survey. I don't think I would have been able to do the video without it, certainly not as well anyway, and his online survey was the complete inspiration for this video. What he did by putting the art style used in the game alongside other possible art styles was encourage me to think, well, if I don't like that one art style as much, why not? What is it about it? What's it lacking? And I definitely have a newfound respect for the art direction in Papers, Please as a result of making this video, so yeah. Huge thank you to Gonzalo. Check him out on Twitter and Instagram. I'll put links in the description. He's a great artist, especially if you like weird and creepy stuff. And also, huge thank you to all my subscribers. I hit 1,000 the other day, which is amazing. It's been a milestone I've wanted to hit for a long time now, and I just can't tell you how much it means to me. It took me a little while to get there, and for a while at the start, I'd upload videos, and no one was really watching them, and it was a little disheartening. But every new subscriber, every like, and especially all the amazing comments and feedback I received really kept me going. And it might not sound like a big deal liking a video or leaving a comment, and before I started making videos I never used to do it, but it really does make a huge difference. When I was having a bad day, just one nice comment could turn my whole fucking day around. And yeah, my last video was shared around on Reddit and did way better than I expected, so I've come a long way and it's been an amazing journey, and I hope you'll all stick with me. Thank you so much. If you're on Twitter, follow me at Thinreaper, and I'll see you next time. Cheers.